And this is one of his most important books, and it's in the history of Islam. This is the only book I know of that actually gathers all of the ahkam in terms of fiqh. So again, it's very important. He begins, Ahmadu Rabbi wa salatu wa salam ala Muhammadin wa alihi al-kiram. I praise my Lord, and prayers and peace be upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muhammad wa alihi al-kiram, and his noble family, which is the Banu Hashim, according to the Malikis and the Hanafis, and the Banu Hashim and Banu Muttalib, according to the Shafi'i school. These are his al. And then also, anajadu kulli taqiyan, even though the hadith has nadar, the meaning is generally considered sound, that his al, like the al of a people, alu Ibrahim, are the people that follow him. So this also includes all of his followers. The people of Islam are all from his family. Salmanu minna al al-bayt. Salman is part of our family. And so he prays it. And, you know, we could go into the hamd. You know, the ulama exhausted all of these things. They have four types of hamd, right? Hamd al-qadim lil-qadim, hamd al-qadim lil-hadith, hamd al-hadith lil-qadim, and hamd al-hadith lil-hadith. They go into all these things in the textbooks about praise and what it is. But the essence of prayer is of praise, is it is a thana. It's basically speaking highly or well of honoring somebody through the tongue. And it can be either for something that they have done to you, which generally goes under shukr, which is a type of hamd, or it's because they're simply worthy of being praised. And so, you know, Allah told us to praise him. He gave us all these means to praise him. And sami'a Allahu liman hamida. Allah hears the one who praises him. And for human beings to want praise is unworthy of the human being to desire praise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-mannan. He can remind us of the good things that he's done to us. But for a human to do that, it's not an appropriate thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands of us praise. And part of the reason in the traditional Jewish story, which many of the ulama quoted, which comes out of the Jewish tradition, but many of the ulama relate it as directly from our tradition. Kuntu kanzan makhfiya fa'aradtu aw ahbabtu an u'raf fa'khalaqtar khalqa hatta ya'rifu an ya'rifuni, that I was a hidden treasure and I desired to be known or loved to be known. And so I created so they could know me. And to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet, he called his beloved Muhammad. And that name was given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This, the ilham, they named him that name. And it was mentioned in all the previous books that he would be Ahmad, he would be Hamid, he would be Mahmud. And these are all his names. And so the Prophet is Muhammad, which is a form of the intensely praised, the one who is praised intensely. And the Prophet to this day all over the world is praised. This is one of the miracles of his name, is that he is the praiseworthy. He's praised everywhere. And those who criticize the Prophet or say things, they're not talking about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They're talking about themselves. You cannot criticize the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is beyond he's beyond any criticism. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when people attempt to condemn him or say anything about him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes their names, their tongues away from his name. One man wrote a poem trying to speak ill of the Prophet, and he called the person he was talking about mudhammam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, look at how Allah sarafa lisanahu anni. He removed his tongue from me. He's talking about a man named Muthammam, and I'm Muhammad. So he's talking about somebody else. It's not me he's talking about. The Arabs say al-qafilatu tasri wal kilabu ta'wi. The caravan moves and the dogs bark. The Rumi says that the moon hears nothing of the howling dogs. as it traverses across the night sky. You know, they can bark all they want at the moon. The moon doesn't hear that. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, even Dante in the Inferno, in that unfortunate section in the Inferno, talks about somebody called Muhammadu. Who is Muhammadu? Whoever he's talking about is not our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And so all of these people that talk about whoever they're talking about, it's somebody else. And much of it is their own projection. Right? It's just they're projecting on. But unfortunately, like Dr. Winter said, the Muslims have to ask themselves if they have helped paint this modern portrait that many people see Islam by. The ugliness of what they perceive as an ugly religion, or things that they perceive about the prophet of this religion. The one who has somt is silence. The one who has somt has gained ta and ta najati. Ta is the Arabs have something called the abjadiyya system. So they have abjad who was hutiya, right? You have this sa'fas, kadam, and qurishat. They have a system where they appoint, assign to every letter a number. So you have like alif is one, ab, and then ba is two, jim is three, dal, abjad, hawaz, hawa, za, and then waw is like six, and then hutiya. So you get ba is nine. So what he's saying is you get nine sources of salvation. Because there's a hadith that the Prophet ﷺ said that al-afiyatu, the well-being, is 10 parts. And then nine of them are in silence and one of them is avoiding people. So this is, if you want to be in a state of well-being, this is how you do it. By not talking and avoiding people. You're not going to have any problems in life. Just stop talking. In other words, this is what the hermits do. They go off to mountains, you know, the sadhus and the. I read in Utne Reader once about a man who went to, they have these monasteries in Greece where they have, the only way you can get to them, because they live on cliffs, is you have to go up a basket. The monks pull you up. So they just stay away from people. They don't want anybody to bother them. So, but sometimes they let people come up. So this man, he was visiting Greece and he went to this Orthodox monastery and he had to go up on the basket. And he was there and looking over the Aegean Sea and he was really having a spiritual experience. And he was saying, I just wish the monk could speak English so he could say something profound to me. And he said, at that moment, the monk turned to him and said, women evil. That's what they're up there running away from. Right. So that's what he says. And then he says, Sabi alafin min al khairati. There's a saying that you get 7,000 blessings in just being silent. You know, the Arabs say silence is golden. إذا كان الكلام من فضة فالسكوت من ذهب. We also say that in English, silence is golden. The Arabs say, if speech is from silver, silence is golden. And then he says, هذا ولما جاء في اللسان ما جاء من الضرر بالإنسان. This is because of all of the things that have come about the harm of the tongue for the human being. والسمع والبصر يشهدان وعنهما يسأل كالجنان. And this is also because the hearing and the sight also will testify. And about them, we will be asked, including the heart. And this is from the ayah in the Quran, إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْؤُولًا. That the human being is responsible. Mas'ul in Arabic means the same as responsible in English. Responsible means you have to be able to give a response. So you're answerable. So the mas'ul is responsible. They're answerable for their sight, their hearing, and their heart. And the ulama say that the sight and the hearing are the inroads into the heart. They're the inroads into the heart. And that's why the hearing and the sight, you have to guard them. Because they will affect the heart. And this is why the ulama say, العين لا تتعلق بكبيرة ولكنها أسرع جارحة إلى إفساد القلب. That there's no kabira that is related to the eye in looking at something. Just to look at something is not a kabira. But it is the quickest of all of these organs to corrupt the heart. If you want to corrupt your heart, the eye is the way to do it. And this is why we're living in a very dangerous time, because there are so many elements. We live in an image-based culture, and there are many things that are very corrosive for your spiritual heart. The inner eye, what's called the basira, because the Arabs differentiate between the basar and the basira. The inner eye is, the spiritual eye is more sensitive than the physical eye. And you know how sensitive your physical eye is. If you get a tiny grain in your physical eye, you can't do anything until you get it out. If a little hair from your eyelash goes in to the eye, you can't do anything until you remove it. That's how sensitive your outer eye is. The inner eye is more sensitive. And some of the things that people do, it's like taking a spike and literally gouging out the inner eye. That's what they're doing. And so the blindness that people have, you can go spiritually blind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that it's not the eyes that go blind. La ta'mad absar. It's not the eyes that go blind, right? But it's the hearts, it's the breasts, what's in the breast that goes blind. So these are all responsible. And janan in Arabic is one of the words for heart. There are many words. The Arabs say qalb, they say lub, they say muhja. They say fu'ad, right? These are all words for the heart. And one of them is janan, which is from what's hidden, because the heart is hidden. Even the angels and shaitan have no access to the human heart. They don't know what you're thinking. Shaitan never knows what you're thinking. That's something that Allah has veiled from everyone. The heart is Allah's domain. وَأَخْبَرَ الْمَوْصُوفُ بِالصِّدْقَيْنِ بِفَوْزِ مَنْ وُقِيَ شَرَّ إِثْنَيْنِ. And then he says that the one who is described as the with the sidqain, the two truthful, he's as-sadiq wal-masduq. What he says is true, and he's believable. So he's both truthful and he's believable. And so these are the two sidq that they were described. Ibn Mas'ud describes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as as-sadiq al-masduq in the famous hadith. And then he says that you will be freed from the shar of the two things. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's a hadith in the Muwatta, Imam Malik relates a hadith, and there are many variations of it, but man dhamina li ma bayna lihyayhi wa rijlayhi dhamantu lahu al-jannah. If you will guarantee to me what's between your two jawbones and your thighs, I will guarantee you paradise. So the tongue and the private parts. Right? If you will guarantee those for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he will guarantee you paradise. If you guard your tongue and you guard your chastity, right? And this is very important. And so, one of the things Socrates, the Greek philosopher, he said that your teeth are like the jail bars, and your tongue is imprisoned, and you should never open the jail unless it's on good behavior. Like you let it out, but you have to be able to put it back behind the bars if it's not, right? So Allah has put your tongue inside your mouth, and you have to open your mouth to speak, right? The fem, you know, we say mouth, ma. It has the same, like fem, fa, ma, fem, fa is an opening, m is closing, right? These are the shafatan is one of the makharij al-huruf. So you have the fa, the wow, and the ba, and the meem, right? So fem is from the two lips to articulate it. And this is what, so you have to open the mouth to speak, and it's what gets you in trouble. And then he said, and now there's a hadith, man wuqiya sharra laqlaqihi wa qabqabihi wa dhabdhabihi wuqiya sharra kulla. That whoever's protected from his tongue, his stomach, and his private parts, right? من وقي شر لقلقه وقبقبه وذبذبه. Like the laqlaq is the tongue, the qabqab is the stomach, and the dhabdhab is the private part. So if you get those three, no problems. If you can guard those three. And then he says, فَقُلْتُ وَاللَّهُ الْقَدِيمُ الْبَاقِي بِيَدِهِ الْأُمُورُ وَهُوَ الْوَاقِي. And I said, so he says, ذَكَرْتُ فِي الْإِثْنَيْنِ مَعَسَاهُ يَكُونُ وَاقِيًا لِمَنْ قَفَاهُ. So I have mentioned in this poem, what if you guard them and follow what I've mentioned, they will protect, يَكُونُ وَاقِيًا لِمَنْ قَفَاهُ. If you follow them, this will protect you. فَقُلْتُ وَاللَّهُ الْقَدِيمُ الْبَاقِي بِيَدِهِ الْأُمُورُ وَهُوَ الْوَاقِي. And then this is, so sharia and haqiqa. He's saying, guard this, but in reality, it's Allah who's the guard. He's the one who protects you. So he's just, لَكِنُّهُ رَبَطَ بِالْمُسَبَّبَاتِ أَسْبَابَهَا وَحَرَّمَ الْمُحَرَّمَاتِ. And then he reminds us though, but he has asbab. So even though Allah is the one who protects you, you're still responsible because he's put you in a world of means, asbab. And he's given you the ability to guard your tongue, and so you're going to be asked about it. One of the things that people do with the tongue is they make things that the sharia has considered or deemed ugly, they make them beautiful, right? They make them appear good. And this is haram to do. Minha wa minha dhammu ma zayyana, and also dhammu ma zayyana is to censure something that the sharia has said is good, right? So لِذَا مُسَمِّي الْحِرْمِ بِسْمٍ يُوهِمُ. So to call something that is haram, something that makes you think that it's permissible, أَلَيْسَ حِرْمًا آثِمٌ وَآثِمُ آتٍ بِمَا يُوهِمُ. So for that reason, anyone who calls something prohibited by name that would falsely allude to its permissibility is a wrongdoer. Like calling, one of the things the Prophet ﷺ said at the end of time, people would drink alcoholic beverages, but call them by, they'll drink wine, but call it by other names. So they won't say that it's khamar. They'll say something else, like it's beer.